you're looking for ways to improve short-term memory, you might have a big problem. You see, people often say they have short-term memory issues, but in reality, they're talking about something called working memory. Or if they really are talking about improving their short-term memory, they're focusing on the wrong thing for the wrong reasons. But here's the very good news. You really can improve your short-term memory, your working memory, and your long-term memory. And the best part is that even though there's a catch, you can do it all in one swift blow. And so, transcend, my friend. Hi there, Magnetic Memorizers. This is Anthony Metivier from MagneticMemoryMethod.com. I've been using memory techniques since discovering the Memory Palace during a dark depression that impeded every level of my memory, and this technique saved both my life and my academic career. After racing from the jaws of death to completing my PhD in record time and becoming a professor myself, my challenge now is to build the world's largest online memory university for the strategies, solutions, and all the insider information to help serious students, professionals, and anyone busy with life like you use memory techniques more efficiently so you can learn faster and remember more. And I've learned a lot by using and teaching mnemonics, as well as interviewing the best memory experts and athletes on the planet for the better part of a decade. So if this learning adventure interests you, I suggest you subscribe now and enable notifications so you don't miss a thing. Hit that thumbs up and join my mission to assist those who are very, very busy with their careers so everyone can tap into the vast powers of human knowledge that can always be at your fingertips, just so long as you can remember it. But here's the problem. A lot of us struggle with the temporary storage component of memory in everyday life. And what we think of as our short-term memory is not as sharp as we would like. Well, I want to do my best to avoid getting us bogged down in the terminology, but it's difficult because there are competing ways that memory experts and memory scientists use the terms. Yet, it is helpful to establish an understanding of these terms and at least take a stab at the nature of this unique memory problem of increasing our short-term retention. So to that end, this video is the first in a short series devoted to the topic, and since short-term memory's role is to store information temporarily as well as determine which information will then be transferred to long-term memory or dismissed, it really is going to take more than one video to help you root out the issues and carve a path forward to what I'll be referring to as transcending the terminology. But before we get to that, let's start by describing how a problem with short-term memory might look like. So imagine the following scenario, inspired by the true-to-life novel and popular movie about early-onset dementia, Still Alice. You're in the kitchen, preheating the oven to make a batch of your world-famous brownies. You've assembled your ingredients on the counter to prepare your batter, and then the unthinkable happens. You only have one egg left in the carton, and the recipe calls for two. At least, that's how you remember it. So frustrated, you grab your keys and head to the store. You remember you're low on paper towels and need batteries for the TV remote, so you put those in your cart as you navigate the aisles, taking note this is the perfect chance to utilize a memory palace. But more on that later. You pay for your items, load up the car, and drive home. You walk back into the kitchen, and happily you see that the oven's temperature is ready for your brownies. And then you realize you forgot the eggs you went to the store for in the first place. It happens to the best of us. Our short-term memory can be seriously lacking at times. Stress, depression, lifestyle habits like sleep, diet, and exercise, even medications, can cause short-term memory difficulties. So what do? Do we resign ourselves to list-making and app dependency to remember daily bits of information? Are we glued to the smartphone or pen and paper as our lifeline against forgetfulness? Don't lose hope. There's a better way. Now, although we could dive straight into the techniques of improving memory so as to not risk getting bogged down by terminology, it's important to first define what short-term memory actually is. We must understand there is a difference between short, long-term, and working memory. It's also crucial to know that there are different memory problems that emerge for each subsection of memory. And though we can't dive into all those issues today, you can read up on them through some of the more in-depth literature I've linked you to in the description below. Keep in mind that I'm not a neuroscientist and am aware of the vast abundance of competing definitions and scientific findings out there. For our purposes, here's what I think we really need to know before diving into the techniques and the strategies discussed in this playlist series. Whereas long-term is more complex, short-term memory is often described by psychologists as an approximately 30-second window with a twofold function that interacts with working memory. This may be one of the reasons so many people talk about the two, as if they're the same thing. With that in mind, short-term memory is one, an ability to understand sentences, spoken and written. It is, at its most basic, tied closely to comprehension with an emphasis on what the brain can process in a 30-second window. 2, short-term memory is the type of memory that helps you understand what you are reading. Without it, you'd be constantly confused when studying, saying, "What did I just read?" Many people have a hard enough time with focus and concentration, having to reread paragraphs, pages, even entire chapters, without having to worry about comprehension itself. So short-term memory is also the type of memory that when you see an infomercial on television, it lets you remember the telephone number to call and order your Flex Seal or airbrush makeup kit for only 3 easy payments of $19.95. Well, it's also discussed by scientists and psychologists as the ability to remember small sequences of numbers, such as telephone numbers and website addresses, like magneticmerrymethod.com/YT, where you can get my free memory improvement kit with 3 books and 4 videos that walk you through creating a memory palace network so you can always remember what you want, so long as you have the skills. Now, regardless of the terminology, which seems to me perpetually all over the map, as different memory experts use the terms in so many different ways, this much is clear. Memory is central to our overall brain function, and to improve it, we must improve all of our types of memory. In a sense, it's like yoga. For example, all great teachers of this ancient practice advise that you make every pose, every transition, a full body experience. Though you may feel a pose in your hamstrings or perform a move that relies more heavily on this or that core muscle, every ounce of your being should go into executing a pose successfully, mind, heart, and soul. We can apply the same principle of holistic connection to how we improve our memory. Our short-term memory does not function in a vacuum, nor does working memory, long-term memory, autobiographical memory, figural memory, spatial memory, or any of the multiple other names given to different kinds of memory. To improve one means we will also tap into our episodic, figural, procedural, echoic, and semantic levels of memory, and you can bet that as science evolves, they'll probably name even more levels. Thus, for magnetic memorizers like us, the name of the game is comprehensive improvement. And isn't that what we really desire anyway? If not, we should, because here's the deal. When we focus on the complete enhancement of all aspects of our memory, we will do more than improve our short-term function. We will also transcend the textbook definitions of memory. And much like yoga, the process feels zen, because once you're into the rhythm of working on your memory, you'll wonder why you never did it before. Everything in your mental life starts to connect, because what else is your current experience except information going into and out of your memory? And once you enter the zen of memory, everything in life becomes so much fun. Now, for inspiration and insight into this transcendent nature of memory, we need to look no further than memory competitors who blur the lines of what short-term memory is defined as. For example, one textbook definition you might see about memory suggests that you can only keep 5 to 8 digits in memory at once. Yet, using a simple number system, multi-world memory champions like Alex Mullen and Dominic O'Brien can memorize a deck of cards in seconds or multiple decks in shockingly short periods of time. I myself competed with Dave Farrow, who has Guinness records in card memorization and can vouch personally for just how fast he is. And don't think for a second this transcendence of what the terminology says should be possible has anything to do with age or gender. Lynn Kelly, author of The Memory Code and Memory Craft, has been awarded several memory competition honors as a senior memory champion using her own memorization techniques. Katie Kermode has used her interest in memory competition to design software, and you can listen to interviews or access resources regarding each of these people by following the links in the description below. But please understand this important point. The real practice put in by memory competitors is not just about playing cards and numbers. When I've personally given memory demonstrations, I've memorized 20, 30 names in only the amount of time it took to hear them. And I did need to hear them, because the rare time I've made a mistake, it's always been a near mistake, such as calling a Graham a William. I heard the am part just fine, but background noise and being 80% deaf in my left ear got the best of me. Not only is what we commonly think of as short-term and working memory limits undergoing transcendence in situations like these, even if you're a little deaf, there's also a lot of mental multitasking going on, because I'm performing recall rehearsal at the same time, while also adding additional details about people as they introduce themselves. It's almost like bullet time in The Matrix, and yet time is flowing exactly the same for the mnemonist as well as everyone else. Back to competing with Dave Farrow, even though he beat me, I did half as well, and everyone in the room was astonished by the fact that anyone can memorize anything so quickly with so much movement, noise, the presence of cameras, and self-defeating thoughts in my head competing for space with the Queen of Clubs and the Six of Hearts. And yet, even with all that distraction going on, everyone can learn to memorize just about anything. And one of the things I appreciate so much about the events Dave puts on is that he teaches absolute beginners, and many of them gave both he and I a run for our money, even though they had learned the techniques for the first time just a few short hours before the competitions began. It's the most amazing thing you'll ever see, and I'd hazard a guess that not a single one of them had ever spent an entire minute thinking about the difference between short-term memory, working memory, and long-term memory. The point is this: the boundaries of what textbooks call short-term memory is not so strict, so rigid, or so limited as Alex Lynn, Nelson Dulles, John Graham, and countless others have demonstrated. What matters is comprehensive memory training, not just an emphasis on one kind or level of memory, such as short-term memory. And now that you know that these memory feats come from specific kinds of brain training, it's worth repeating this simple fact. To really improve, you need a holistic, comprehensive memory training program, ideally one that leads to long-term memory benefits that offer you predictable recall. You also need to practice consistently over the long haul. That's the catch. But it's such a wonderful price to pay as you enjoy the lifelong adventure of learning at a higher level because you know what your memory really is through experiencing it more directly. And in order to give you long-term predictable recall that transcends the terminology, the first step I recommend and personally continue to benefit from the most is the consistent exercise of spatial memory. And this is where my free introductory course, The Magnetic Memory Method, and using a robust Memory Palace network comes into play. So take some time now, if you don't have a Memory Palace network, to create one. If you have one already, expand it. Again, if all this seems foreign to you, come visit me at magneticmemorymethod.com/YT to get started today. Make sure you're also subscribed to this channel and enable the notifications so you don't miss our community live streams or interviews with memory experts and detailed playlists like this one. And if you have questions for either myself or your fellow memorizers in the Magnetic Memory Method community, drop them in the discussion below. Let's keep the conversation going. In our next video on short-term memory and how to improve it comprehensively, along with all the other levels of memory, we'll talk about apps that claim they can improve your short-term memory. Of course, as we've seen, it's pretty complicated for them to make that claim when there are so many ways this term is used. And coming up in the next video, I've got an exercise for you that I'm confident will help you experience far more profound and lasting memory improvement instead. And until then, thanks for watching, hit that thumbs up, come visit me at magneticmemorymethod.com, and keep yourself magnetic.